In this session, I'll be quickly covering all x-rays of the upper limb. So let's start with the first x-ray, which is here. This is a x-ray of the left shoulder region. Okay, how can I identify it is left? Because most of the x-rays which are of sides, they have markings on it. We can see L here. Okay, so if I try to hold it of the other side, this L is going this side. Okay, we have to mount the x-ray in such a way that we are looking at the patient. That means the patient is standing in front of us. Okay, so this is an x-ray or a skiagram. Okay, when we use this term, skiagram is a better word for describing this film. Okay, x-rays were the rays used to produce this film, but the correct name of this film is called as skiagram, also referred to as radiograph. Okay, and so in the upper limb x-rays, all are plane skiagrams. Okay, so this is a plane skiagram, anteroposterior view of the left sided shoulder region. Here the bones visible are, this is the scapula with the glenoid cavity, this is the humerus with the upper end of the humerus, the head of the humerus, which is forming a shoulder joint here. Okay, and then we can see this is the shaft of the humerus, then remaining part of the scapula, try to identify. This is the lateral border of the scapula, this is the superior border, this is the coracoid process of the scapula, and then this is the clavicle. Okay, then these are the shadows of the ribs. Okay, so the bony shadows are referred to as radio opaque shadows, and the dark shadows that we can see, those are referred to as radio lucent shadows. Okay, soft tissues give radio lucent shadows and bones give radio opaque shadows. Okay, so this was about the left shoulder region. Then again, this skiagram is also showing the left-sided shoulder region. Okay, so just focus on this upper part. Again, we can see the same structures that we have identified now. The shoulder joint with the head of the humerus, the glenoid cavity, the coracoid process, and acromion process is clearly seen here. It was not very clear in the previous x-ray. This is the acromion process, and this is the clavicle. And again, the shadows of the ribs and the left lung is seen here. Okay, now this skiagram is showing the shoulder joint as well as the humerus. Okay, so this, we can say this skiagram as a skiagram of the arm. Okay, so this is also left arm because L is mentioned here. Okay, so humerus is the bone of the arm, so we have to describe the humerus bone in its entire extent in this skiagram. So we can see the head of the humerus, the neck of the humerus, the shaft of the humerus, and the lower end of the humerus. Lower end has got projections, those are referred to as medial and the lateral epicondyle. The larger projection is of the medial epicondyle, and this one is the lateral epicondyle. Okay, and some upper part of the radius and ulna are also visible. Radius is the lateral bone, ulna is the medial bone. Okay, so you have to describe the shoulder joint as well as the different parts of the humerus, and the soft tissue shadow is of the muscles of the arm that we can see here. Okay, so mostly taken to check if there is any fracture of the humerus. Okay, let's see the next skiagram now. Now this skiagram is of the elbow region. Okay, so elbow joint is formed by humerus and ulna and radius, so that we can see the bones here. We can see the lower part of the humerus, this is the ulna, and this is radius. Okay, and when we are holding this skiagram, make sure the humerus is superiorly, don't hold it in such a way that the radius and ulna is above and humerus is below. Make sure you keep the humerus above. Okay, and this is the left-sided elbow region. We are viewing from the anterior aspect. We can identify this left side because of the presence of this medial epicondyle. Okay, so you need to identify the different parts of the lower end of the humerus, the different parts of the upper end of the radius and ulna. So we can see here, this is the head of the radius, this is the neck of the radius, then this elevation is referred to as radial tuberosity, and then this is the ulna. Ulna has got two parts, the olecranon process, the coronoid process. Okay, so that is seen here. So two different views has been taken here. One, this view is referred to as anteroposterior view, and this view is referred to as lateral view. Okay, because in fractures that there can be different kinds of displacements, like side to side displacement. If it is there, then it would be visible in this anteroposterior view. And if there is an anteroposterior displacement, then it would be visible in a lateral view. Okay, so two different views has been taken here. Then let's see the next skiagram. In this skiagram, bones of the forearm are visible. The radius, ulna. Okay, here also AP view as well as lateral view is taken. In lateral view, we can see the overlapping of the bones of radius and ulna. Okay, so here we can describe the lower end of radius and ulna as well as the carpal bones. So if entire radius and ulna is visible, this would be called as the skiagram of forearm. Okay, it's a plane skiagram of forearm, anteroposterior view, showing the forearm bones as well as the wrist joint. Okay, and this carpal bones would be more clear in the skiagram of the hand. So we'll identify the carpal bones in this skiagram. So here this is a plane skiagram, anteroposterior view of the hand region, showing the wrist joint as well as joints of the hand. So here we need to identify the lower end of radius and ulna. Okay, there is a projection of the radius called as the styloid process. Ulna has got a projection called as that ulnar projection is also referred to as styloid process. Okay, ulnar styloid process is small, the radial styloid process is thick. Okay, and here in the carpal bones, you have to identify row wise. Okay, proximal row of carpal bones, lateral to medial. Here we can identify the carpal bones. This bone is scaphoid, then there is lunate, then there is triquetrum, which is overlapped by pisiform. Okay, then there is trapezium and trapezoid, a small bone, and then this large bone is the capitate, and then this is the hamate having a hook. Okay, so these are the carpal bones that you need to identify. So there is a proximal row of carpal bone, there is a distal row of carpal bone, and there is one joint formed here. This is the first carpo-metacarpal joint, a saddle variety of synovial joint. Okay, and then identify the metacarpals and phalanges. Metacarpals are identified from the thumb side, first, second, third, fourth, and the fifth. And then these are the phalanges. Okay, thumb has got two phalanx, remaining all fingers has got three phalanges: proximal phalanx, middle phalanx, and distal phalanx. Okay, so this was about the x-ray of the hand, and we can see some small bones also. Additional bones are seen, so at times there might be sesamoid bones at the level of head of the first metacarpal. Okay, the flexor pollicis brevis muscle has got this sesamoid bone. And this side we can see the lateral view of the hand. Here the many bones are overlapping, so individual bones are difficult to identify here. Okay, in this skiagram we have to look for the scaphoid fracture. Okay, whenever there is a fall on an outstretched hand, scaphoid is prone to get fractured, so that can be seen in this region. Okay, so this was all about the upper limb x-rays. I'll stop here.